Hi, I'm Laura Flanders, and this is CityWorks, a co-production of the City University of New York School of Labor and Urban Studies and CUNY TV. Each month here at CityWorks, we explore the lives of working people on the job, at home, and in our communities to see in what ways New York can achieve greater social and economic equality. Joining us this time, a hero of radical activism and journalism, Juan González. For 50 years, he's documented the struggles of working people in New York City, among other places, as a columnist for the New York Daily News, in books, in classrooms, and as co-anchor of Democracy Now! Born in Puerto Rico, raised in New York City, Juan was the first in his family to go to college, one of few Latinos at Columbia University at that time. But in 1969, he felt compelled to leave his studies to help form what became the Young Lords, a militant group dedicated to improving living conditions in the barrio. He'll tell us much more, but suffice to say, for a spell, the Young Lords changed healthcare in the South Bronx, turned up the heat on the authorities, lifted spirits and consciousness, and their legacy lives on. By 1978, Juan was writing stories that continued that same work, first at the Philadelphia Daily News and then at New York Daily News. He covered uprisings in Crown Heights, Los Angeles, Washington Heights, and in 91 led a landmark strike at his own paper. Along the way, he also managed to produce documentaries, host shows, teach courses, and write best-selling books, among which Harvest of Empire, a history of Latinos in America, which has been a bestseller on the topic for a quarter of a century and was recently reissued last year. Fallout on the environmental impact of the collapse of the World Trade Towers, and with Joseph Torres, News for All the People, the epic story of race and the American media. Juan has won just about every prestigious journalism prize from the Polk to the Pulitzer, and upon his retirement last year, he received a rousing proclamation from the New York City Council itself. Extraordinary Juan González, welcome to CityWorks. Let's talk about your arrival in New York. We want to talk about what you've seen in terms of change, but take us back to the very beginning, just to begin. I mean, your parents, who were they? What did they do? How did you end up here?
Well, my parents were both were born and raised in Puerto Rico. I was actually born in Puerto Rico, but came here when I was just 2 months old. My mother brought me as a 2-month-old baby to New York City, and right after World War II, my father was a kitchen worker all his life. He dropped out of school to cut sugarcane in Puerto Rico when he was in the fourth grade, and my mother was a seamstress and worked in the garment industry in New York City before moving on to work as a hospital clerk. So they were both working class. And as you mentioned, I was the first person in my extended family to go to college, not just my immediate family, but all my cousins and everyone else in the family. I was the first be able to attend a university.
So there you were at Columbia University, huge deal. And yet you felt compelled to leave your studies. Why?
Well, I was actually kicked out of Columbia during the 1968 student strike as one of the leaders of the strike coordinating committee. I was suspended from the university and then went on to, as you mentioned, to within a year or so to be part of the founding group of the Young Lords in New York City.
That moment is one I want you to take us back to, and then I want you to reflect on where we've come since. But before we skip forward, talk about that. You were 21. The Young Lords are increasingly being remembered today, but it is a history that deserves to be better understood, better known.
Yes, there's been a resurgence in recent years. Several books have come out analyzing and dissecting the story of the Young Lords. And I was actually the oldest member of our leadership when I was 21 years old. Everyone else was 18, 19, 20. We even had a person on the Central Committee who was 15, Juan F. Ortiz. And I think the average age of the Lords was about 17. So the emphasis should be on young. We were a very young organization, but managed to accomplish an amazing amount of stuff in a very short period of time through the sort of daring, bold nature of our actions and our ability to build alliances with other radical and revolutionary organizations of the time, specifically the Black Panther Party, the Republic of New Africa, the Congress of African Peoples, the Students for Democratic Society, and other organizations. We were able to fashion alliances that really stood the test of that period in terms of building interracial unity.
You were also providing real services.
Yes, we were firm believers that you don't make revolution by having intellectual arguments, but you have to have concrete advances or reforms that improve the conditions of people. So we organized things like free breakfast programs before there was a federally funded free breakfast program in the public schools. Free clothing programs, lead poison detection programs, tuberculosis detection. We would go door to door in East Harlem and the South Bronx, providing these kind of screening tests, and then using the data that we got from the screening test to be able to pressure New York City to change its policies. The activities of the Young Lords really were instrumental in getting New York City to pass a lead poison abatement program, requiring all landlords to remove lead-based paint from their tenements. It was our documentation, along with articles by crusading journalists like Jack Newfield at the Village Voice, that exposed the epidemic of lead poisoning in New York City back in the late 1960s and led to those reforms.
So is that what led you into journalism?
I'm sorry?
Is that what led you then into journalism?
Well, I had already been interested in journalism. I've been the editor of my high school newspaper, but then when I got involved in activism, I got sort of deviated a little bit. But the interesting thing is, I always make the point, of all the radical and revolutionary organizations of the 1960s and early 70s, the Lords had perhaps the best press coverage, the most sympathetic press coverage. But it was because we actively worked to control our own narrative. So we produced our own newspaper, Palante. We had a radio show, a weekly radio show on WBAI back in 1970. And we also understood the importance of being able to package our message and our stories for the commercial and corporate media, thanks to a visionary minister of information, Pablo Yoruba Guzman, who had read Marshall McLuhan when he was a student at Bronx High School of Science, and who understood the necessity to package your message according to the medium.
Yeah.
One message for radio, one for TV, one for print. So Pablo was ahead of his time in terms of being able to understand that it is important for radicals and revolutionaries to control their own message. And so we were able to get the message out to the media in New York City and in the East Coast of what the Young Lords stood for.
Marshall McLuhan, the guy who coined the phrase, the medium is the message. So in your story so far, I've heard you came from a working class background, first generation immigrant. You get to a university after a high school experience, already interested in journalism. You see activism as imperative. You find a sort of way to work intersectionally with all sorts of other organizations to achieve some concrete goals and learn the value of journalism along the way. So much of what you described today, I just want to ask you, do you see that trajectory open for people in this moment? Or how has a young person at the age that you were at 21, how have their opportunities changed today, do you think?
Well, I think the biggest problem is that back then there were also external factors that were driving more and more young people to the necessity of social activism. Of course, my senior year at Columbia in 1968, our strike started only a couple of weeks after Martin Luther King was assassinated. Over 100 cities in the United States erupted into rebellions in the 1 week after Martin Luther King was killed. The Vietnam War was at its height. And if you were a young person in college in 1968, the last thing on your mind was, what kind of job am I going to get when I graduate? The real issue was, will the country stay together? Will it erupt into civil war? And so there was that the external factors forced young people to make political decisions and get active. Today, there's so many aspects of society that divert the attention of young people, that send them off in other paths, that entertain them. And of course, the U.S. imperialism learned a very important lesson from the Vietnam War, which is that a volunteer or professional army is much more necessary to an empire than a draft army. Yeah. And so when the United States ended the draft, it allowed the country to continue to intervene and get involved in wars with a much more reduced portion of the population suffering the brunt of the war, professional soldiers, instead of 10 people going to Vietnam for a year of peace, as happened back then. Now you're getting two people doing five tours each in the various wars, whether it's Afghanistan, Iraq, wherever the United States sends its troops. So that really, the rest of the country doesn't really suffer the brunt of war the way that it did during Vietnam. So I think those things all collude or coincide to make it possible for young people to avoid the necessity to get socially active. But with all that said, I believe that young people are more progressive and more open to change and racial unity and progress and ideas of socialism than they were back then. It's just that they don't fight as hard, they're not willing to take as many risks, and they're not staying persistently in these movements, but the movements rise and fall very quickly.
We'll pick up more with Juan González, our guest, and talk about media when we return. We'll be right back.
The CUNY School of Labor and Urban Studies is the 25th and newest school under the CUNY umbrella. Dedicated to public service and social justice, the CUNY School of Labor and Urban Studies offers undergraduate and graduate degrees in the areas of labor studies and urban studies, and certificate programs in labor relations, public administration and public policy, healthcare policy and administration, and community leadership. We pride ourselves on being an institution that brings together activists and academics. Find out more at slu.cuny.edu.
We're back with Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist and professor Juan González. He's joining us from Chicago today here on CityWorks. Juan, I should mention that you are teaching journalism. You've done it for many years. You've worked with journalists for many years. You've helped to expand our journalism world immensely through both the teaching of people today and the reminding us of buried history. And in your book, News for All the People, which I have by my bedside, you remind us how today's world of a few media monoliths is a relatively new phenomenon. Can you just share with our audience some of what you and your co-author discovered as you put that book together about the extraordinary history of journalism in this country?
Yeah, well, I think one of the things that people often fail to understand is that there are many streams of the American media. And we basically broke it down, my co-author Joseph Torres and I, into three main streams. What's commonly considered the media, which is the corporate or commercial for-profit media, which has its own history dating back to Benjamin Harris and Public Occurrences, the first newspaper in North America in 1690, and Joseph Campbell's The Boston Newsletter, up through the barons of the late 19th and early 20th century, Pulitzer, Hearst, and up through the corporate giants, behemoths of our age, you know, the Time Warners, the Fox Newses, the New York Times, and the other big chains of today. But there are two other streams of the American media that have also been critically important. One is the dissident press, the alternative press that has its own history going back to the working men's publications of the 1830s, the great muckrakers of the late 19th and early 20th century, Ida Tarbell, Lincoln Steffens, Upton Sinclair, Jacob Riis, all of these others who tried to contend over the narrative of the American experience with the corporate and commercial press and provide a different perspective. And because both of these, the dissident and alternative press and the commercial and corporate press, systematically excluded people of color, African Americans, Native Americans, and Latinos from their newsrooms, people of color were forced to create their own press. Freedom's Journal, the first black newspaper in the world, John Russworm and Samuel Cornish in 1827 in New York City, the lead editorial in their first newspaper, "We wish to plead our own cause. Too long have others spoken for us. From the press and the pulpit, we have suffered much by being incorrectly represented." Yeah. That was the lead editorial, March of 1827 in Freedom's Journal. You could write that today and it would still have resonance. Likewise, Latinos were forced to create their own press. There were 25 Spanish language newspapers in the city of New Orleans before the Civil War, including a daily. There was a daily newspaper in Spanish in New Orleans before the Civil War. The Native Americans had to create their own press. The Cherokee Phoenix, the first Native American newspaper in the world. The Cherokee didn't even have a written language until the early 1820s, when Sequoia developed an alphabet to represent the Cherokee language. And by 1828, the entire Cherokee nation was literate, and they were producing their own newspaper. And of course, the Chinese press, beginning with Golden Hills News in 1854 in San Francisco. And there were at least 25, 30 Chinese language newspapers in the United States before the turn of the 20th century. So there was a vibrant press by people of color that contended with the racial narratives that existed within the commercial press as well as the dissident press. And you really can't understand the press in America until you have a firm grounding of the histories of the contending narratives that existed over the same facts and the same occurrences. And I think that's one of the things we try to amplify the understanding of people of what is the media in America.
And where does that contention stand today?
Well, it's still going on, although it's become a lot more complicated, because clearly the commercial press has gone through the same period of understanding that if they're going to be relevant, they must address in one form or another the concerns of people of color in an increasingly multiracial society. You have the growth of what I now call the diversity, equity, and inclusion industry. There's an entire industry that has arisen over the last few years to basically placate people of color, to give them the outward appearances of paying attention to their needs, while never really challenging the systemic and basic class contradictions in the society. So that I think that this is the new frontier that we're dealing with now, which is for people of color to understand that capitalism is in a period now of co-optation of these movements, of offering grants and new positions and new institutes to rising African Americans and Latinos and Asian Americans to quiet them down, to wait until the upsurges of mass movements calm down, to then reinstitute the old methods of dealing. And so it's a complex situation to understand that it's happening in the media, it's happening in the universities, it's happening in the corporate world, because they, as long as people do not challenge the basics of the system, which is class exploitation and which is imperial domination, you will have freedom to say whatever you want or to rise up the ladder of success, but do not challenge empire and do not point to the unities, the class unities that exist among most of the people in any nation, or you will be ostracized and demonized.
I always say it's not white fragility that's the problem, it's capital solidity that's the problem.
Yes, absolutely.
So let's talk about that. And let's talk about the type of journalism that you did at the Daily News for so many years that did name that elephant in the room, the systems of colonial capitalism that we all live under. I was going to say you were this great, hero of social justice journalism. And then I thought, well, what's journalism supposed to be for, if not social justice in a sense? How do see our media today? I mean, they will talk about politicians, they'll talk about personal problems, they'll talk about scandals, but they will rarely name, they sometimes might talk about markets, but they will rarely name the system under which we live as to blame for anything. And that makes it very hard, I think, for organizing. So can you talk a bit about how journalists of today might get at this question, might talk perhaps more directly to how do we move forward?
Well, I think it's important to understand that in the corporate and commercial media, you cannot really, on a consistent basis, challenge the basics of the system, because that is the model under which the media have arisen. The advertiser-driven model of journalism, which requires basically an alliance between the media owners and the advertisers. And in one way or another, in fact, the whole idea of objective journalism, as I have often pointed out, the idea of objective journalism, the press in America was always highly partisan and highly political. It was only in the aftermath of World War II that there was the creation of the Hutchins Commission in the 1940s that began, because the press was so discredited, so hated by the people in the 20s and 30s because of its crass commercialism, there arose this idea that journalism should be objective, above the fray, and it dovetailed perfectly with the creation of monopolies of newspapers in every city, because once you had a monopoly paper in one town, you needed all the people to read that paper, and you needed the advertisers to be willing to advertise in that paper. So you had to create sort of a common ground of journalism, which is what objective journalism represented. It represented in the political sphere, how do you deal with monopoly in newspapers?
You sell the idea that you only need one. There's only one version of the truth.
You know, and everyone can be fit in one way or another, and that the journalists who are writing are not politically partisan, which of course they are. but the lie or the deception for the next 50 years was that objective journalism would be the standard, the gold standard of journalism, so that the advocacy journalists. You go back to the muckrakers, Upton Sinclair, Ida Tarbell and her exposés of the Standard Oil Company, Ray Stannard Baker's exposés of racism in the South. None of this would have happened if these journalists did not feel the intensely the need to right a wrong. And so basically, the objective journalism was an attempt to reject the social advocacy bent of journalism that had arisen in the early 20th century and through the communist and socialist period of the 20s and the 30s. But what happened? Technology, which I always believe, technology is a destabilizing force. Every time a new technology of communications develops, it upsets the existing order and then forces the elite of the country to figure out what are the new terms under which communication, mass communication, will occur. And so what happened is, as a result of the developing technology of cable and then the internet, there was a breaking up of the media system. And so we are still in the period of destabilization where no one has figured out what new model for providing good-paying jobs in journalism to produce decent stories, what model will that be? It won't be advertiser-driven anymore. A lot of people are thinking, well, it's a subscriber base. So now you have everyone trying to get subscriptions and get you to subscribe. Well, I think that that's going to end up, the New York Times is one of the few institutions right now that's getting more revenues from its subscriptions than it's getting from its ads. Yeah. But there's only so many subscriptions that people will pay for on a monthly basis to get their news and information. So there's a limit to that. And of course, the big issue becomes what happens to local news. Yeah. There will always be a news organization or a capitalist who is willing to pay to control the narrative at the national level. But who is going to report to you what's happening in your local school board, in your local city council, in your planning and development meetings, and your zoning boards? These are issues and decisions that are being made, even in your state legislatures.
Yeah. We're running out of time, Juan. I would love you to close by just addressing yourself, as you probably do to your students, to people watching out there who want, who maybe are inspired by what they've heard, who want to be the Juan González of today?
Well, I think the key thing to understand is individuals don't make change. People do in groups. So you have to join organizations and groups, build them, and also not divide. It's very easy to have a battle or division and split. Organizations have to be built and greater unity created to affect social change. And I think that's the main lesson that we learned in the Young Lords, that 10 or 15 people, if they stick together, can do far more than 100 or 1,000 people who are not organized and united. And then the question is build. Keep building the strength of your movements. Don't weaken them and don't divide them. Always remember, a better world is possible if you're willing to achieve it. You know, you've got to be willing to go after it and make the sacrifices necessary to make it happen.
Oh, well, we'll make the sacrifices necessary to be here in New York without you, Juan, and we wish you well in Chicago. I'm sure we're going to hear from you again. Thank you so much for joining me.
You can still hear from me on Democracy Now! In the mornings.
Exactly right. You can find Juan any morning on Democracy Now! But that is it for CityWorks today. Thank you so much to Juan González for being our guest. If you have comments or questions, write to us at cityworks@slu.cuny.edu. For CityWorks, I'm Laura Flanders. Thanks for joining me.